I want to ask you to share with us your views on this single, very important, and burning question. Was Hildegard von Bingen a feminist?
I'd say yes and no, more no. Here's what's important to keep in mind. You're looking at someone who's living in the Middle Ages. It's a very different time period. Feminism, the term that we know and understand here in the 21st century, that was not a term or concept that really evolved until the late 20th century, especially the 1960s. So Hildegard would never have considered herself a feminist. She never knew the term or the concept. And of course, in these, you know, earlier periods, there were women who definitely went against the grain, fought against patriarchal ideologies, but they did not know the term feminism. So we cannot really say and impose that label on them when they weren't cognizant of that term. What we can argue, and what some scholars do argue, is that Hildegard is what's considered a proto-feminist, that she, her visions, because some of the visions, you could argue, do have some feminist implications, not that they are necessarily feminist, but they do hold implications. So because of that, you're kind of heading in a direction towards feminism, but you're not really there yet, okay? Here's what's interesting about her. On the one hand, you've got someone who presents herself as an obedient daughter of the church. She even claims, "I am but a poor female creature, but I'm going to tell you these visions because it's this living light that's telling me to tell you these visions." So this is kind of a rhetorical move on her part. This is how she gets leverage and how she gives herself authority in a society where she doesn't have any authority, okay? So you've got that. So on the other hand, you know, her lived experience is very different from the way she presents herself to the church authority, because she's got to make the argument that she's, you know, this poor, feeble female, but it's a divine light that's telling her she has to tell you these visions. So, but her lived experience is something different. She doesn't, when she has to move her community, right, when they move to the, across the Rhine, I think,
yep,
it is. I mean, that's, whoa, I mean, that's going against male-led church authority, okay? So that is not humble, that is not
right.
Self-deceiving.
Right. Right.
That takes a lot of guts to do. So again, she openly resists authority, but yet she never deviates from the actual church teachings, okay? In fact, she makes the argument that women should obey their husbands. So here we see an example of how she's kind of reinforcing these patriarchal kind of notions that were prevalent in that time. And she's saying that that's a natural role, because in the social order, men are here, women are here. It's sort of this binary opposition where the person here is the one who's got the privilege, the one here is the subordinate, and this is the natural order of things, okay? But yet she defies church authority. So she's kind of in this gray area, and I don't mean 50 shades of gray, but this is why she's kind of considered a proto-feminist, because we don't really know what to make of this. Her religious writings, again, they reinforce some of these patriarchal notions, but what's also interesting is that here's an abbess who's writing openly about sexuality.
Mm-hmm.
For that period, that's pretty revolutionary. But some of those writings do, again, reinforce some of the the notions at the time. So she condemns masturbation. She's against same-sex relations. Women are weak. And virginity is the highest level of spirituality that you can attain. But for all of that, what was I going to say? Within a heterosexual context, the relationship, and well, she actually advocates for female pleasure. And the reason behind that is that if a woman receives pleasure, it actually allows the sperm to take root in the womb, and that's what enables conception to take place. So she's kind of making this case for female pleasure. So, but in a kind of heterosexist, patriarchal kind of way. So it's, again, it's this gray area.
We actually see this in the film.
Do you? Okay. Well,
you'll see there's actually a little interesting exchange between Hildegard and Bolmar.
Yeah.
Nothing kinky. Just a
So again, it's interesting to see how she is in this kind of gray area. So that's why, again, I don't think we can really necessarily place the feminist label on her. But I have a question that I'd like to pose, and you don't have to answer, but this is just something to think about. Is using feminine imagery or a cosmic vision that seems to value the feminine, is that necessarily feminist? Because I really don't think so. Just because you're venerating the feminine does not make it feminist. There's a difference between feminine and feminist.
Right.
So there's.
I think she begins to give a little more equal weight to the feminine, because so much of I guess writings, teachings, and emphasis was on male divinity or male imagery.
Yeah. And she specifically says that God is the Father, even though she gives this sort of feminine imagery, and she says, well, I can't even bear to look on the divine if not in a feminine form, but she still acknowledges that God is a father, not a mother, okay? But Julian of Norwich, who we'll see after Easter, she actually has a different take. Whereas Hildegard of Bingen sees God still as a father, still as a masculine, primarily masculine deity, Julian of Norwich kind of sees both masculine and feminine mysteries together in the Godhead. And we especially see this through Jesus, whom she calls our tender mother. So we'll get to that in April. But
looking forward to that.
Yeah. But you know, again, like, I think a really good question we need to ask ourselves today in the 21st century is, what do her visions of Hildegard's visions of God say to us today about women, about women's relation to the Godhead, about the divine feminine, and God's feminine, you know, mysteries, attributes, you know, whatever you want to call it. What do these visions say to us today? It's almost like when we take a piece of scripture and we read from it, and we have a different lens reading scripture in the 21st century than previous generations have had. We've had different insights on scripture based on our social and cultural and historical setting.
Yes. Yes, I think Hildegard does speak to us in a lot of different ways today after so many years of she just sort of disappeared, but she speaks to us today, I think, in many, many, many ways and a lot of levels. Maybe we can't even articulate, but we're starting to get to know her a little more and process her. She is fascinating on many levels. So those are excellent questions, and thank you so much for illuminating us a little more on whether she is a feminist, because she brings in the feminine, and it's unique.
Yeah.
And we want to know a little bit more.
Yeah.
Look forward to Jennifer. Jennifer will be leading the two classes on Julian of Norwich. Dates to be announced.
Actually, I think April 9th and April 16th.
Okay, and it's this, so it's to, after the Celtic, after the Celtic on Thursday, so same time.
And it'll be in the Guild Room.
Okay, which is downstairs. And you'll be let in if you've never been in the Guild Room.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome.